If you're a visibly disabled person, the chances are that somebody, often a complete stranger, will have come up to you and said something like, gosh, if I was like you, I couldn't go on. I'd rather be dead.
I've had it said to my face in front of people. I've had it said at work.
A friend saying, well, you know, if your condition progresses to the point where you can't kill yourself, you know that I'd be happy to do it for you. And this wasn't someone I was particularly close to.
If my life was like yours, I'd want to kill myself.
He actually told me that I should go and kill myself because, you know, then I'd stop being a drain on society.
See? Better off dead. You probably think that, looking like me, I'd be campaigning for the choice to ask a doctor to put me out of my misery if things ever get that bad. You know, assisted dying.
A group of academics backing proposals on assisted dying.
We have to make sure that people can have an assisted death.
She is considering the option of assisted dying.
But I prefer to call it what it is, assisted suicide. If you think this is just about terminal illness, think again. This is about disability. And for me and others, that is terrifying.
There's lots of nasty illnesses you might get.
There is no journey here, no one-way ticket to Switzerland.
Would you go with me to Switzerland to Dignitas if I had wanted that?
I would never have agreed to that.
I'm really clear what my views are on this subject, and they will remain the same in the end. I only know that because we're filming this at the end. There have been many TV documentaries on this subject, but not one from our perspective, from disabled people like me, who aren't religious, who are just really afraid of these laws. So this is an attempt to redress that balance.
To want to kill yourself over who wipes your backside.
It's coming at us from all angles, like a pincer movement.
The law is changing in a lot of places. Watch this space for after the election.
These laws, I believe, will put lives like mine, marginalised lives, at risk. And those risks will be fatal.
No assisted dying law can be 100% safe.
Imagine choosing death over homelessness.
I was marking time.
All because of the dangerous assumption that some of us are better off dead. Am I stuck properly?
Yeah, you're beautifully stuck. There we go.
Would you do me?
Of course I would.
Right. It's just theoretical.
I know.
You might know me as an actor, I would like to presume. I was for 8 years in the BBC's forensic drama Silent Witness.
Said Inspector C. Clark. Injured in the line of duty.
Larissa Mullery, injured in the line of gestation. And now I find myself, in big shows. How did that happen? I don't know. I had no idea till my 30s that I was ever going to be an actor. Came late in life. I get an excuse to dress up and be in medieval times, have a wooden wheelchair. I love all that stuff. So why leave the red carpet behind to come and make a documentary about not legalising assisted suicide? I want to talk it through with a friend of mine. Have I got that Claudia, that Winkleman fringe?
We both have.
Now you look beautiful.
Now you look beautiful. You. Lisa Hammond is one of my good friends. You might recognise her from the telly. Grange Hill. Vera. EastEnders.
Where do we form most of our opinions about the world? From what we consume, from the media. Everything from documentaries to sport to entertainment, reality TV, all of that. We are not represented. And if we are represented in those arenas, well, it's usually like charity cases.
Yeah. Documentaries about looking for a cure.
Looking for a cure better. Or inspiration porn, i.e. superhuman.
Sure.
Narrative.
Paralympics.
Or you're suffering so badly, you're in terrible pain, or you become disabled and you now want to kill yourself.
Do, sad music.
Yeah. Plinky, plonky.
Always the journey, always ends badly depending on what you want, in Switzerland, a death clinic.
And if you believe all that you see, why wouldn't you think you'd want to end it if that's the case? It's like me before you.
Yeah, of course, me before you. Attractive, young...
Rich.
Rich, smart young man.
Yeah.
Has an accident, becomes a wheelchair user, falls in love with his hapless carer.
Of course, yeah.
And then, like in all good rom-coms, he goes off to Dignitas to die.
Yes, classic ending.
And the world will definitely be a better place without me.
No. No, it won't.
The hashtag was live boldly because at the end, he's like, I don't want you to have to look after me. I don't want to keep going. I'm going to leave you some money and you go off and live a life. Yeah. The message of the film, live boldly, go forward, unless you're disabled.
Yeah, totally.
Well, it's the first time, isn't it, that I think internationally...
Everyone came
disabled out. ...disabled people...
Well, were, and was like, this is not OK.
We feel that you're saying that there were better deaths than disabled. We want rights, not tragedy.
Rights, not tragedy! Rights, not tragedy! Rights, not tragedy!
It's the glorification...
Of death.
Our choice to die.
Definitely.
It's the right thing to do for ourselves and our families and society. Mm. I didn't think I'd ever live on my own, have a partner, have a career, have mates, you know. It's...
Why would you think that's possible? Like, that's crazy. That's craziness. Why wouldn't you need and want to die in that case?
It was the media portrayal of assisted suicide that ultimately confirmed to me that it is about disability.
Almost 800 Britons are on a waiting list to die at Dignitas.
There are some people who perhaps don't want to wait until the very end.
She's a prisoner of her own body, serving a sentence that will only end with her death.
My first BBC appearance was live on Newsnight back in 2008, opposing assisted suicide, of course.
If a non-disabled person wants to commit suicide, it's a tragedy. As soon as a disabled person does, you know, it's a release.
Let me show you what I mean. If you saw someone on a bridge about to jump, would you stand by and let them do it? Would you support them in the name of choice and autonomy? No, you would probably intervene and suggest that they get help. But if it was a disabled person, would your response be the same? Or would you see their decision to end their life as understandable, even inevitable? Many of us feel that assisted suicide creates a two-tier system. Suicide prevention for some, suicide approval for others. I've not always been disabled, but my experience of becoming so might help explain my views. Yes, it's that time in the documentary where I go to visit my mum.
March 1981. You started back at school and you said that you didn't feel like a child like the rest of the class.
Mm-hmm. At the age of 7, I was diagnosed with an autoimmune condition. It was serious, rare, like winning the lottery, rare. And it completely changed my life.
June 1982, you weren't well again and you still got depressed. But the new school is better, as the girls don't make fun of you. OK?
I like that. That's no, that's almost like a high point.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm.
I guess to that comparison, you know, I was there and I was not Queen Bee, but I was one of the popular kids kind of thing.
And in the school plays.
And then I become not that person.
Yeah.
I become the person that people are scared of, the other kids are frightened of. I mean, I think that's hard. Your kind of status changes hugely.
Mm, absolutely, yeah. Mm. November 1984, she is very lonely. She gets very down and often says she wants to die rather than carry on, as she can't see any good in the future for herself. And you're only 12 years old.
I just didn't have any memory of actually saying that I had wanted to die. Mm. And a frightening thing for me would be if that was possible.
Mm. Yeah.
Because if you took those who love me away, or you took my career away from me, you took my care package away from me...
Yeah, life would be very different.
It would be very different.
Mm.
But would you go with me to Switzerland to Dignitas if I had wanted that?
I would never have agreed to that.
Wouldn't you?
No way.
No, but Mum, you've supported everything.
Yeah, I'm not going to lose you, but whatever. No way. No.
I wish I could travel back in time and tell younger me the truth, that life, an imperfect but pretty bloody good life, awaited me. I found my tribe, other disabled people, disability politics, a different way of viewing the world, and activism. Can you hear the bells of I saw disability in a completely different way. I saw it as the barriers in society and not me as the problem. Changed my life, absolutely. One of the people responsible for this is disability rights campaigner Baroness Jane Campbell.
Come in, Jane. Come in, Liz.
And where better to meet a member of the House of Lords and her husband than in their garage? Slightly underwhelmed. In case you're wondering, the garage also doubles as HQ for the campaign group I'm part of. Not dead yet. We want to keep the existing law, which sees assisted suicide as a criminal offence rather than a medical treatment.
I've been a disability rights activist for disability equality since I was probably at school, when I was at special school. So, yes. Sorry, Roger, did you go give me a section?
Which is how I became aware of you, was as disability rights up there, kind of goddess, really.
Oh, I know more about assisted suicide. I can tell you, wherever it has been legalised, the criteria widens. So they begin by saying, oh, it's only people who are in the last few months of death. This isn't for people like you. But it is, because I've often been in that situation. Do you know, I was at a DLR when I went into hospital, to a general hospital, with a routine chest infection.
A DNR, or do not attempt cardiopulmonary resuscitation, means if a patient's heart or breathing stops, their medical team will not try to restart it. Ultimately, it's a medical treatment decision, but ideally, doctors should consult a patient about their preference.
Roger was told that it was in my best interests not to ventilate me or to resuscitate me. Well, what did they mean by that? I had a job. I had a family. I had responsibilities.
When you found that out, because presumably you found it out before Jane, I'm guessing you were unconscious.
Yeah. No, it was a very worrying time. And, of course, when they tell you that your wife isn't worth saving, you initially think they have superior knowledge. They've seen a zillion people in this situation. They know what they're talking about. And it's only because you then think about it a bit more that you realise that they've gone for an option, but there are much better options. I mean, Jane's problem when she arrived at hospital was she was dehydrated. So perhaps if I hadn't been there and Jane hadn't been able to articulate for herself, well, then she wouldn't be here now.
People look at us and think, oh, we're in need of care, we're weak and vulnerable. We are not. We are probably the toughest people out there because we have to problem solve every single day of our lives.
I like to think we're the cockroaches.
Yes.
We'll be here forever.
We will.
Because we've sort of evolved ways of living.
Yes.
I mean, obviously, if you take electricity away, we're pretty fucked, but apart from that...
I think the noble Baroness Lady Campbell of Surbiton has been trying to get in for some time. I think the House would like to hear from her.
Yes. I thank the noble minister. And I'm sorry I haven't got a louder voice.
I've got no doubt that Jane's presence in the Lords, I mean her actual physical presence, has been crucial to defeating the many repeated attempts to legalise assisted suicide through Parliament.
people are decent, kind, but they think that they're doing us a great favour by giving us this choice. But what they don't realise is how deadly that choice can be.
I wonder if any other subject has been thrown back so many times.
Well, cause... I've been there 15 years, and I feel like I'm in Groundhog Day.
Assisted dying is not supported by the very people it is intended to benefit.
Is the Noble Lord the Minister aware that the campaign to legalise assisted suicide is not supported by one single organisation for people with progressive conditions? My Lords, this is a popular bill. There is no doubt about it. But it is not the right bill, and I will not support it.
In the past 20 years, there have been 8 attempts to change the law, including one in the first 18 months of COVID. The last time there was a vote in the Commons, in 2015, MPs voted 330 to 118 against legalising assisted suicide. House of Lords, Lord Faulkner has sponsored 4 bills that would allow terminally ill people with less than 6 months to live to have medical assistance to die. He used to be a Lord Chancellor, he used to be a QC, now a KC. So I think that means he's going to be very good with words and arguments, very clever, very thoughtful. Yeah, I'm quite nervous to meet him, but I'm also really keen to hear his perspective on this. I think I better go. Let's start with then, you would like change, I don't want change.
Yes, we have to do something about the law, because if you want to take your own life because you are terminally ill, you've either got to do it yourself without any help, or you've got to go to Switzerland, do it earlier than you might otherwise have to, in alien surroundings, maybe without those that you love. And I am very in favour of changing the law to allow people who are terminally ill to be assisted by a doctor to take their own life, but only subject to safeguards, because for disabled people, one needs very much to ensure that there are appropriate safeguards.
Is this about pain and suffering, or is it about control?
Very often, it is about control. It is very, very frequently not about the intensity of the pain.
Should we be changing the law for those people?
Without a doubt, yes, because even with the best palliative care, there are a group of people who will always want to be in control of the process and will want the process to come to an end. It's not about people who are suffering from any sort of condition that is not going to end their life within the next 6 months.
Actually, ironically, where some people see this as giving them control and power, I see it as giving away control and power. And I have faith in the NHS, but I equally know the realities of the system. Would I trust a law like that, where the consequences of getting it wrong or the consequences of mistakes are so great? Would I trust that to a government? Would I trust that to this government?
No, but with respect, I think the reason I disagree with what you're saying is you're putting two things together there.
Okay.
I think you are right to identify massive inequalities in the way the healthcare system operates, and particularly how it operates in relation to, for example, elderly people or, for example, disabled people. But does that make me think that there'll be a sort of a huge number of these cases going through wrongly? Most certainly not.
You may have all the integrity in the world, and I hope you do, in this matter, and I believe you. the other campaigning groups don't want it just for terminally ill people. There are so many groups already pushing, and that's what makes me think it will change. It will come from the pressure.
Once, I think, a legislature decides it's going to be terminal illness only, it will stick at that. But I could be wrong about that, but I don't think I am. The line in the sand for me is terminal illness, and it goes no further than that.
But the thing about sand is that it shifts. And nowhere demonstrates this better than in Canada.
Daydream, I fell asleep amid the flowers for a couple of hours.
I'm in Vancouver with my mum and my wife, Jo. I've been here on holiday before, but this trip's a bit different.
I'm going down the slippery slope.
Assisted suicide, when you're supplied with lethal medication to take yourself, and euthanasia, when a doctor does it for you, were both legalised in Canada in 2016. It's a government-funded scheme delivered through its public health system and is called Medical Assistance in Dying. But everyone in Canada knows it as MAID. In the beginning, yes, to qualify, you had to be terminally ill with a reasonably foreseeable death. But that safeguard didn't last long. Now, normally, I hate this gratuitous shot in assisted suicide documentaries. A disabled person looking sorrowfully out of the window, the world outside, somber music playing. But I couldn't resist. From my room, the building where we're going today, I could see it. And it's this just everyday building. And that's where the person I'm first meeting works. I'm off to see Ellen Weeb, a doctor who's performed hundreds of euthanasias. I feel quite nervous. My head's full of, what shall I ask her? What do we talk about? And also, will I like her? Well, I enjoy meeting her. You know, all those sort of confusing things. Don't eat anything. Don't drink anything.
Don't sign anything.
But I also want to know things that I think you don't see and hear about normally. Somebody's died. There's been a death of someone. Whatever we feel about this subject. So what? What is the room like when it's done? How does everyone else feel and how does she feel? Hello. Hi, I'm Liz. Hi.
Hello.
Thank you for
nice
seeing
to meet
me. You too. Should we do hands and whatever? Are we very formal? Or do we not?
I don't know. We don't need to be formal, but we also don't need to touch hands.
Fine, good. So you do this work actually here? Sometimes.
Most people want to die in their own homes.
Yeah.
And so I would be in their home. And of course, many people are in hospital, in hospice, in care homes. And then there are people who don't feel comfortable dying at home. For example, they don't want their spouse to have to deal with their memory of them dying in their home. So then they come here, and this is a recliner. And so people recline here, and they can snuggle up with their loved ones if they want. And so it's a good place for some people. Mm-hmm.
According to law, each MAID applicant must make a written request signed by an independent witness and have two independent medical assessments.
So this is the one that has to be signed in front of an independent witness.
And who would that be if I...
It has to be somebody who is not in the will and not a direct caregiver like me.
Could your receptionist or...
Yes, like because they're not directly involved in care.
How many MAID deaths have you been involved with?
Over 400.
Okay. That sounds like a lot. Is that what you do now?
I still run a contraception and abortion clinic in addition to my MAID work.
Would you ever say no?
Of course.
Yes.
I mean, we have a law, and I obey this law. And so there are people who are not eligible under the law. Now, there are the situations where I might find somebody not eligible or eligible when another person won't because of the way our law is written.
In your experience, what do you think is the number one reason that people want made?
The number one reason is autonomy, control.
And what?
Everybody's different in what they think of as autonomy and control.
Yeah. So that would be about not wanting to lose that in their lives.
Yes. Control. They desperately want control. Like, they want to say, it's now. And we say, okay, well, I can get back here at 7 o'clock. Is that okay? And they'll say yes, and they'll be so grateful that they can skip the last 2 days of their life. And I look at it and think, all you really needed was some more drugs, but you want my drugs, I'll give them to you.
Apart from the fact I don't have the desire, I think probably I would be eligible under the Canadian law.
Well, you'd have to be suffering unbearably, and you'd have to convince me that you were suffering unbearably.
And from what you said, don't worry, I know you're not going to do anything here and now. And I'm not as always. I'm not scared. But I guess what I'm saying is there could be somebody next to me with exactly the same condition.
Yes.
Who doesn't want to go on anymore.
I've certainly met people who are no more disabled than I am, saying that life is not acceptable in this state. And I would say, you and I are different, but not different in the sense of wanting to have some control. So, Liz, right now you love life and you want to live, but there's lots of nasty illnesses you might get. And if you got terminal cancer and you were having to deal with chemotherapy and radiation, wouldn't you be thrilled that if you had the choice to say, I'll go this far and no further?
For me, I'm concerned that giving the option and the right to a group of people puts another group of people at risk. But I don't feel that you see that as a worry.
What you're saying is to protect what you consider vulnerable people. You are condemning others to unbearable suffering. Unbearable suffering. And I am so glad that I'm a Canadian and that we have this law so that people can choose that or not choose that. But to say that somebody has to suffer like that is simply cruel.
Do you love your job?
I love my job. You know, I've always loved being a doctor, but and I delivered over 1,000 babies, and I took care of, you know, families. But this is the very best work I've ever done in the last 7 years. And people ask me why, and I think, well, doctors like grateful patients. And nobody is more grateful than my patients now and their families.
Psst. Nice chat.
Let's get out of here.
I lit up from Reno, I was trailed by 20 hounds. Didn't get to sleep that night till the morning came around.
In the first year, over 1,000 Canadians ended their life using MAID.
I ran down to the levee, but the devil caught me.
Only 6 years later, the annual figure had leapt to over 13,000. Incidentally, the Canadian Medical Association has published an analysis showing how MAID could possibly save its public healthcare system hundreds of millions of dollars.
So, I'm here to make a documentary.
Yeah.
And it's on MAID.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's not a comedy.
No.
Maybe it would be funny if the pace of expansion wasn't quite so scary. There are now two pathways, or tracks, as they're officially called, to access medical assistance in dying. Made for terminally ill people is track one. This is now a fast track, allowing people to be assessed and euthanized all within 24 hours. But since 2021, there's a new pathway, track two. This extends the law to those with a medical condition who are suffering unbearably, but whose death is not reasonably foreseeable. The assessment period for this track is 90 days. So track two makes MAID accessible to disabled people who aren't terminal. Both tracks have the safeguard of a sign-off by two medical professionals, but it's become clear that there can be significant loopholes.
This is one of my favourites.
Wow, you look alike.
Alicia Duncan's mum, Donna, was involved in a minor car accident resulting in concussion. During the months that followed, Donna's health declined, but the exact cause remained a mystery.
My mom speculated that she had something called central sensitivity syndrome that the car accident had triggered. Mm-hmm. What we didn't know is that she was restricting her diet. She would say that it would hurt to eat solid food, so she was pureeing everything, having soups. She was very paranoid. She worried that if she left the house, she might be shot by a sniper at any moment. And I think that's when we really started becoming extremely concerned that this might be a mental health issue.
And this was completely uncharacteristic to your mom.
Completely uncharacteristic. My mom was a highly educated psychiatric nurse.
How did MAID enter the equation?
I received a text message from my mom's common law partner. He wanted us to know that my mom was in the beginning stages of looking into MAID. We just thought there was no way. There was no way she would be approved. And my sister went to go see her and asked, how did the assessment go? And she said, do you want to know? And my sister said, yes. Mm-hmm. And she said, I've been approved. So we had less than 48 hours notice that my mom was going to die.
For Donna's own safety, her daughters gathered enough evidence to have their mom taken into custody under the Mental Health Act.
I pled with a doctor because, of course, my mom was a psychiatric nurse who knew all of the right things to say. At the end of the 48-hour hold, they did another assessment. We received a text message from my mom's partner that evening that my mom was dead and her body had been taken to a crematorium.
Donna was approved for track one of MAID, the fast track, on the basis that her condition was terminal. But her daughter disputes this.
My mom wasn't terminal, and she wasn't facing imminent death. However, if you're depressed and you starve yourself to the point that you are malnourished, they can bump you up to track one and you can die right away.
But if you were behaving like that, wouldn't that suggest there was mental health issues going on?
It would, but if you've starved yourself, that's physical. My mom had been approved by the head of the MAID program and a nurse practitioner. The second assessment, it was done over the phone. He never saw my mom.
They had no relationship with your mom?
None.
They were not her doctors?
No. And her general practitioner, who had been her GP for 20 years, would not approve her to die.
I don't know how you move on from that.
And I feel guilt for not fighting harder, for not, I don't know, kidnapping her and taking her into the woods and keeping her safe, you know?
look at that.
Wow, look at that.
I want to take a picture for Joe. I can't do it properly, so I need you to do a selfie.
I've never done a selfie. Yeah.
So look to the left, press to the right, try and smile.
Okay. Miracles you want me to perform.
Okay, go for it.
Right.
Smile.
Smile.
I'm glad you're here, really.
I'm glad I'm here, love. Eh?
Medical assistance in dying has become such a normal part of the Canadian healthcare system that as well as there being a 24-hour suicide prevention hotline, there's now a 24-hour MAID hotline too.
Thank you for calling. The Ontario Medical Assistance in Dying Care Coordination Service is designed to provide information about end-of-life options in Ontario and as well referrals for medical assistance in dying. If you would like to speak with an advisor to access the service or get more information, please press 1.
Everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody
but stories have started to emerge suggesting MAID is being chosen for reasons that have nothing to do with health.
The good guy's lost. Everybody knows the fight was fixed.
Hello.
Hello. Amir.
Hi, I'm Liz.
Nice to meet you.
Amir
Farsoud is a disabled man who was struggling to survive on state benefits.
For the last almost 8 years, I've had the misfortune of being on Ontario Disability Support Program, which gives a maximum of just over $1,300 to a single adult.
Weekly, monthly?
Monthly. Okay. Just as a frame of reference, the average one-bedroom apartment in this province costs almost twice what a person on ODSB makes. This all started when the place where I was living in was put up for sale. I would no longer be able to live there. Literally after like 4 months of looking, there was no place. There did not exist a place that I could afford to live in. At which point, I decided, okay, I'm not going to be homeless.
You'd been homeless
before? I'd been homeless before. The winters here are harsh. 6-7 months of the year having sub-zero temperatures 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. There's people that try to keep warm with makeshift fires and end up burning to death. There's people that freeze to death. The one thing I knew was that no matter what, homelessness was off the table. The options were miraculously find a spot, kill myself, or get MAID. And there was no fourth option. But I did tell my doctor right off the bat that while I qualify for medical reasons, the reason I'm asking you is my socioeconomic position at the moment.
The doctor nonetheless approved Amir under track 2 of MAID, based on unbearable suffering. This means that after a 90-day assessment and waiting period, the applicant, Amir in this case, can be euthanized. By contrast, waiting lists for social housing in Ontario can be over a decade.
And was basically just, you know, waiting for the 90 days to be up.
I was going to say, did you have a date?
Yes, I did. I was marking time.
Yeah.
I was the condemned guy who's waiting for, you know, his hour. I got a call from a reporter in Toronto who said, you know, would you mind if I came up and interviewed you?
Imagine choosing death over homelessness. That's what one St. Catharines man is contemplating.
Are you afraid to die?
Who isn't? Yeah,
Amir Farsoud has applied for medically assisted dying, known as MAID. He lives in constant agony due to a back injury.
A woman in Toronto saw the story, started this fundraising thing online for me. And in 4 days, it raised $60,000 and allowed me to pay off my debts and can actually afford rent. If not for her, I would have died at the end of November last year.
He would not be here. But for socioeconomic reasons, that's just...
Yeah.
Are you going to celebrate this year?
my death anniversary. Yeah. I'm thinking about having a few friends over and raising a glass and saying, you know, it's been a year since my death and I'm still here.
You could say something like, I made it.
Yes. Hey, that's good. I'm going to use that.
Have that for free.
All
have
right, it, take cool. It. I'm going to order a cake with you know, the writing on it.
And a syringe.
Yeah.
Maybe. I don't know.
God, you're good.
Thanks. Everybody knows. Amir could have been euthanized because he's disabled. Because he's disabled and poor. Not everyone can use MAID because they're suffering from poverty and other social ills. No, that's a privilege reserved only for those who are ill and disabled. In the future, MAID will be available for people with mental health conditions. And as if it couldn't get any worse, a parliamentary committee recommends extending the law to mature minors. That could mean children as young as 12, the age I was when I first said that I wanted to die. Everybody knows.
Everybody knows. That's how it goes.
Feeling like slightly like a children's TV presenter and wearing pink, all very cosy, the Medical Assistance in Dying activity book. This is for children who have a relative who is thinking about or who's going to use medical assistance in dying, euthanasia. You know, it takes you through the process. The first medicine makes the person feel very relaxed and fall asleep. They may yawn or snore or mumble. The second causes a coma. A coma looks like sleep, but is much deeper than regular sleep. I'm not sure if that's consoling to a child or useful. I don't know. Here's a list of some feelings. Perhaps I was most concerned about the one that says excited. These sort of things just, they give me like a shiver and a fear and an absolute please don't allow this in the UK. Canada is not the only country I'm crossing off my travel itinerary. Other countries where some form of assisted suicide and or euthanasia are legal include Belgium, Netherlands, New Zealand, most of Australia, 11 American states, Spain, Portugal, Switzerland, Austria, Colombia, and Canada. But see, overall, it's still only available to a small percentage of the global population. However, in many of these countries, the law applies to disabled people. Great. It's not just me and a few friends who are worried about what would happen if we opened the door to assisted suicide here in the UK. Professor Catherine Sleeman is an expert in palliative and end-of-life care at King's College London.
There are some specialties where doctors are, on the whole, supportive towards assisted dying. Mm-hmm. And there are other specialties where doctors are, on the whole, very much against. And palliative care is right at one end of that spectrum, followed by geriatrics. Mm. It's perhaps not surprising that the two types of specialists who are most opposed to assisted dying are those who spend their days working with the most vulnerable people in society.
In your practice as a doctor, do people often ask and want to end their lives at that point?
I have had occasional patients who've said to me, this is intolerable, can't we do something to end things sooner?
Yeah.
And every time that's happened in the past, we have managed to make a plan to address some of those intolerable symptoms to make them tolerable again. I'm not going to claim that palliative care can always end all suffering. But what I would say is that perhaps a more important focus is the fact that too many people actually miss out on any palliative care at all.
Yeah. But if there are limits to palliative care, is there then a place for what's called assisted dying?
All arguments for assisted dying really based on autonomy. It's my right, my choice, my decision. Yeah. And I listen to the stories of the people who have decided that that is what they want, and I, you know, they're very, very compelling and moving to listen to. But there's a difference between, is assisted dying morally okay? Is it the right thing for that individual? And should we legalise this? Is it the right thing for our society?
What has led you to that understanding, I guess?
So I think the big concern for me is safety. It's ensuring that those who are perhaps more vulnerable in our society to being coerced into an assisted death are protected from that. And I suppose my background in palliative medicine exposes me to people who I think are vulnerable to that. Mm. Coercion does happen, definitely. A classic example would be talking with someone about going to a care home. Patients will say to me, well, I don't want to go to a care home, really, but I know my family want me to do it, and I know it will be easier for them, so I think I'm going to say yes. Mm. Now, that example doesn't intrinsically worry us, but substitute the words go to a care home with have an assisted death, and I think it's a completely different picture. So it's about coercion. It's about vulnerable people being pressurised into having assisted deaths, primarily. Yes. That's the greatest harm, the most catastrophic risk, I would say, of changing the law.
What makes you think it could create more harm?
No assisted dying law can be 100% safe. Mm. That means that there will be people who slip through the net. Mm. The question, therefore, is, well, how safe is safe enough? What margin of error would we as a society find acceptable? So to put some numbers to it, would we accept the death of one person who didn't want to die in order to allow the assisted death of one who did? Or maybe that ratio is 1 to 10, or maybe it's 1 to 100. Those are the questions we need to be really grappling with as a society, because there's a lot of talk about safeguards, and the implicit implication is that safeguards will make this law 100% safe, but they won't, they can't. So the question we should be asking is, okay, how safe is safe enough for us?
Of course, not all disabled people agree with me on this subject. Melanie Reed is a journalist who often uses her column in The Times to push for a change in the law.
Hello, Liz.
Thanks for this, Mel.
Come on in. I'm so sorry about the weather. Come on in.
Melanie became disabled after a horse riding accident over a decade ago.
Before my accident happened, I was arrogant about my health, and I had this assumption that I would cruise into old age. My parents both lived till they were 88, and it was like, oh yeah, I'm going to have, you know, a long working life and be fit and healthy, and everything's going to be fine. And so when my accident happened, it was a crashing fall, psychologically as well as physically. Mm-hmm. I was plummeted overnight. From I was 52, I was fit and healthy, and I was sort of catapulted into extreme disability.
I get that. You've just joined the most unfun, unsexy, tragic gang in the world. Mm. And no wonder people want to die at that point.
I can see that if you feel you are intrinsically vulnerable, that you belong to a minority who do not fit the world that is created by our laws and general society, that it would be much easier to be labelled as a burden. Mm-hmm. And I can indeed see where your side of the argument and assisted dying comes from. Where I come from on the debate is the sense that I have a human right to decide what happens to my body. Mm-hmm. And I would like to have it. And I rather sort of resent the fact that it is almost like one small group imposing its values upon a larger group.
Well, I would see the small group as those wanting medically assisted suicide. There's two lines here. For some people, if they ever got in that position, it acts as an insurance policy. It's helpful to know it's there in case. And many people won't even use it, but they want to know it's a possibility.
And then there's another group of people for whom the fact that it's a possibility is frightening. Because if you're, to some levels, disabled or come under the criteria, you qualify all the time. You're not going to qualify in 20 years' time or if you get ill. You qualify now. And so when days get bad or all your care package is pulled or you're having a rubbish time, then it sits there. It's like a permanent sword of Damocles.
But would you not like to be able to offer people like me, if it could be done, some kind of insurance policy?
I think the law's about protection, even protecting us from ourselves. I met Lord Faulkner. He said if the law comes in, it will absolutely just be for terminally ill people.
I would prefer it to be slightly wider than that, because what about someone like me who isn't terminally ill, but for whom life could be unbearable in other ways, and I would like to end it? Why should my right to do that be denied? Why do I have to wait until I have something terminal, until I have that right?
Change the law and it still won't work unless we change the law to be for a much bigger group of people. And let's be aware of what that means. Maybe it's going to be like Canada. That is terrifying. I'm back home with my activist mates. We're living the lives that many pushing for assisted suicide fear. But guess what? With the right support, we also represent what is possible when disability is not viewed as a reason to kill yourself.
Society are terrified of becoming us.
Definitely. Yeah.
That's the thing. I mean, I get strangers coming to me and saying, oh, I feel so sorry, why are you in the chair? I said, why are you sorry? I don't know what you're going on about wheelchairs. That's the one thing that makes me independent.
I think what strikes me is that a lot of people in favour of assisted suicide, one of their arguments is this sense of a loss of autonomy. And they list all of the things that, you know, you can no longer do. But what they don't realise is that losing your independence and losing your ability to physically do things you could previously do doesn't have to mean a loss of autonomy. You know, no man is an island. We're not, and we can't actually be independent in everything we do. Yeah, there's loads of things that I can no longer do. If I can't wipe my own backside, then I can have somebody else do it. And the result is the same, and I can get on with my life.
In the documentaries that are a pro assisted suicide, or there's usually semi-naked people being bathed or sitting on a shower chair or in a bath, this sign of indignity.
And yet, while someone's giving me a wash, I'm usually doing my work emails in the morning, getting ahead on them.
Because yeah. You can do two things at once.
Which
I can't do, because I have to wipe my own bum and have to do...
I almost feel sorry for you, Simone. But that's the funny...
I'm so glad, Jamie, you mentioned about having your backside wiped. I can't remember the last time I could reach my own bum. I do get it, but I don't get it as well, because to want to kill yourself over who wipes your backside...
It's a terror of, like, this loss of dignity or this loss of dignity.
And that's it, isn't it?
I'm quite happy, like, chatting to people half-naked during my morning wash, because actually I've learned that that has nothing to do with my inherent dignity as a person. And knowing that makes me feel so much freer and safer, because my dignity is something inside me. And I wish that more people could have the security and the safety of knowing that.
What concerns me is that it will be a state's way of saying, well, this is a cheaper alternative to giving you these packages and giving you the support because you're too expensive to treat.
Until we can really say that every single disabled person has access to all of the high-quality medical treatment, all of the high-quality care they need, that there are no barriers to make life any harder for disabled people than anyone else, then fundamentally we're creating a group of people and saying, well, you're suffering, so if you want to end your life, you can. But we're also making that group of people suffer and want to end their lives.
I think one of the comeback arguments is reasonably
We can't put in all that support for everybody.
But wait, what kind of rule of nature is it that we can't give people what they need? It's entirely a human and a political decision. And assisted suicide is literally just the easy out. It's literally that rather than investing in the services people need, we can just give them a way out.
Sing myself to sleep, a song from the darkest hour. Secrets I can keep inside of the day.
This feels like a good point to end the documentary. I've explained my views. My favourite song is playing in the background. But there's something else I need to talk about first. Recent events have proven that me and the other disabled people who oppose assisted suicide are right to be worried, very worried. I believe that COVID has shown the extent that some of us are viewed as less important, less valuable, disposable. It felt as though as a country, we were divided into people who were worth saving and those of us labelled as having underlying health conditions who weren't. We heard of those with COVID being sent into care homes, of blanket do-not-resuscitate orders being placed inappropriately on older and disabled people. Treatment was prioritised based on someone's age or what they could and couldn't do. And when you find yourself in that group, it seemed that older, ill and disabled people became collateral damage.
My life is out of control.
As an older disabled woman with underlying health conditions, I was more likely to die from COVID, but I was just as scared of dying from inequality. I'm not sure, really don't think, that if that's how we view different groups of people, older people, disabled people, ill people, should we be giving more power to end that group of people's lives? Explore how different countries view different forms of assisted dying with an interactive map produced by the Open University. Go to the website on screen and follow the links to the Open University.
I could be a teacher in a classroom full of scholars. I could be the sergeant in a squadron full of wallets. What a waste. What a waste. What a waste. What a waste.